There was a time, I remember it well from my grade school days, when students were taught to write all fractions in lowest terms. But in recent years, there has been less emphasis on this practice. We will now look at lowest terms and see an example of why lowest terms is sometimes convenient. Let's look at three bars that all have the same shaded amount. We'll go for 8 parts out of 12, 4 parts out of 6, 2 parts out of 3. The fractions for these bars are all equal because the bars have the same shaded amount. So we have 8 twelfths equal 4 sixths equal 2 thirds. And we have 12 parts here, 6 parts here, 3 parts here. Notice that there is no bar with fewer than 3 parts that has the same amount of shading as these bars. For these fractions, we can say the 2/3 bar has the smallest number or lowest number of parts. So we say 2/3 is in lowest terms. 2/3 lowest terms. Let's look at another example. This time we'll use the bar for 9/12 and 3/4. Now once again, these bars have the same shaded amount, so their fractions are equal. Since there is no bar with a smaller number of parts that has the same amount of shading, the fraction 3/4 is in lowest terms. Notice in this equality that the numerator and denominator of 9/12 can both be divided by 3 to obtain the fraction 3/4. But the only whole number that divides into both the numerator and denominator of 3/4 is 1. This is a test we use to determine if a fraction is in lowest terms. Let's go back and look at the first example. We had 8 twelfths equal 4 sixths equals 2 thirds. Now we can divide both 8 and 12 by 2 to get 4 sixths. We can divide 4 and 6 by 2 to get 2 thirds, but the only whole number that divides into both 2 and 3 is 1, so the fraction 2 thirds is in lowest terms. In general, given any fraction, if 1 is the only whole number that divides into its numerator and denominator, the fraction is in lowest terms. For an activity with fraction bars, students can remove all the zero bars, here's 1, and all the whole bars, here are 2, and sort the remaining bars into two piles, those whose fractions are in lowest terms and those whose fractions are not in lowest terms. So let's just pick a few of these out here. This bar, 2/3, 1/3, 4/5, 3/5, 2/5, 1/5, 5/6, and so on. Now, one thing students might notice is that the lowest terms pile contains all the yellow, green, and purple bars. That is, all the fractions whose denominators are 2, 3, and 5 are in lowest terms. This can be generalized to all proper fractions whose denominators are prime numbers. Before leaving this topic, let's think about the advantages of writing fractions in lowest terms. Suppose there are 30 fifth graders out for the soccer team and 10 played on last year's team. We can say 10 30ths of the students played on last year's team, or we can say 1/3 of the students played on last year's team. Students will be able to see that fractions with smaller numerators and denominators are easier to think about. In this video, we looked at an example of why lowest terms may be convenient. Students will have no trouble seeing the advantage of the smaller numbers used in lowest terms. But on the other hand, lowest terms may not be convenient. For example, the fraction 3/20 is in lowest terms. But if we wanted the percent for this fraction, then the equal fraction, 15/100, would be much more convenient. The lowest terms game from fractionbaz.com will help students recognize and write fractions in lowest terms. In the lowest terms game, the player is given 24 fraction playing cards face down. The player turns over one card and clicks one of the two buttons, lowest terms or not lowest terms. If the fraction is not in lowest terms and the player can type its lowest terms, the player receives a bonus of 3 more cards. The object of the game is to win as many cards as possible.